So, thank you very much for inviting me to this and bringing me back to an area which has been for 22 years my home. As you have heard, I've been working in Konstanz for a long period of time. Toxicology has a lot of problems, and nanotoxicology is amplifying these problems, as I will show you in a minute. Arnold Lehmann was the head of the Federal Drug Administration in the 50s, and he said, you can become a toxicologist too, in two easy lessons, each of them 10 years long. So this is the first day of 20 years of toxicology training, if you want to become a toxicologist, are not yet. I have made quite exactly these 20 years, and as any brave scholar, I started with 10 years of learning how to do toxicology. And then I had another 10 years where I learned to doubt how we do toxicology. And this is the first part of my lecture. I want to show you a little bit what problems toxicology is facing at this very moment and why there is a need to revamp some of our strategies and why actually this is very closely linked to some of the challenges your field, your area is giving us at this very moment. But I would like to introduce, first of all, our Center for Alternatives to Animal Testing, CAT. And I use this tag of a t-shirt, which reads, these t-shirts were tested on animals, they didn't fit. And this is exactly the type of problems we want to address with CAT. This center wants to work where animal experiments are not appropriate. And I will give you some ideas why, in toxicology, the animal is not always the right answer. And CAT has been created at Johns Hopkins University 29 years ago. Only last year, we created a joint venture between the University of Konstanz and Johns Hopkins to create CAT Europe as an independent branch. Very, very happy that Harald Krug is one of our board members and creates a natural link to some of the activities being discussed here. CAT is an information hub, is trying to be a think tank for toxicology, as you will hear later on in this presentation. So, toxicology. Safety. Let's see. This is toxicology is dealing with a lot of different products. We are dealing with chemicals, we are dealing with pharmaceuticals, we are dealing with food, we are dealing with cosmetics. Important areas, about 3 trillion each are traded each year of these different products, and still 200 billion of cosmetics. And as you know, nanoparticles are in all of these. So they are. We're using essentially the same methodologies to make these products safe, to regulate them. And we want them to be safe not only for us, healthy adults, but also for vulnerable populations, as shown here. What we're using is essentially animal experiments. These animal experiments are costly. Toxicology, as we perform it today, is a $3 billion business. It is even more if you consider the contract research organizations which are executing these things. But $3 billion of testing cost to regulate products of an annual turnover of $10 trillion is only 0.03% of the turnover of these industries. And for this reason, most of these industries, without questioning, take the burden of toxicological tests. It is something which is necessary to enter markets to get rid of certain liabilities. However, I would like to show you that it is not only the animal welfare aspect, but much more important, it is the possibly wrong decisions we are taking based on the traditional methodologies we are using, which are actually of a major concern. So the take-home message I want to give you is that regulatory toxicology desperately needs to renew its toolbox. And this is not only to address new challenges as nanotechnologies, and I will refer regularly to your field during my presentation. So let's give you a feel why I believe that toxicology needs to go back. And I want to use an example most of you will have actively tested. This is aspirin. Aspirin is the oldest chemical synthetic drug on the market. 112 years old. If you would run today's toxicological toolbox on aspirin, we would have, first of all, labeled it as harmful if swallowed. I hope this is not the case. The acute toxicity in rats is 150 to 200 milligrams per kilogram in rats. This is exactly the daily allowed maximal dosage which we use in patients. So we are treating our patients with doses of aspirin which would kill 50% of the rats. There's no safety factor of 100 or 1,000 as we typically require for new things. It is an eye irritant, a respiratory irritant, a skin irritant. The good news, it is not carcinogenic. But it is a co-carcinogen. It has been shown in two studies to amplify carcinogenic effects of other substances. It has unclear mutagenicity findings, and is producing embryonic malformations in essentially any animal species tested. Cat, dog, rat, mice, rabbit, and monkey data are available. We know that this is not really of major concern. 50 tons of aspirin are produced every year. It is almost a blockbuster with $900 million of turnover. And 74% of my now fellow American are believing in a survey that this is the eighth world wonder, actually. The embryonic malformation have been excluded for humans in meta-analysis, analyzing 89,000 pregnancies with aspirin use. There is no indication of anything like this. So you could say it would be difficult to bring aspirin to the market today. Or other way around, we can be very happy that 112 years ago there was no regulatory toxicology. But I don't want to argue against regulatory toxicology, and we'll take the same example. This is an advertisement from Bayer for aspirin, as you can see. But quite interestingly, Bayer did also advertise at the time another product, which is called heroin. Heroin was synthesized by the very same chemist, Felix Hoffmann, only 2 weeks after aspirin, by acetylating, in this case, morphine. It became very successful, but not in the pharmacies. It was meant as a sedative for coughs at the time. So there is good reason to look what companies want to bring to the market and for regulation. There's another aspect in toxicology, and this is the number of substances we have to face. Chemists are ingenious. They have produced so far 70,000 chemical substances. That's the number of chemical abstracts, 70 million chemical abstracts, what has been described and synthesized. 100,000, roughly, substances we find in daily use to different extent in our environment. However, toxicology, with all these efforts, 3 billion per year, has been able to extensively test only 2,000 to 3,000 of these chemicals, mainly drugs and pesticides. We have hardly any information for the majority of substances which we are using on a daily basis. And it is hardly possible with a machinery which is able to cover 200 to 300 substances per year worldwide, to cover now mixtures of substances, challenges of nanoparticles where one substance can give so many different products with different biological activities, or natural substances. Makes no difference whether a substance is synthesized by Mother Nature or whether it's synthesized by a chemist. One plant extract can contain up to 40,000 individual substances. So if you want to evaluate this, certainly not with a machinery, which is as costly. One pesticide, the toxicological toolbox, is $20 million to test one substance thoroughly. So in Europe, there's a certain progress now to address this problem of many untested substances, very few which have actually been tested. You all know about REACH. The chemical legislation from 2006. REACH expected that some 27,000 companies would register 30,000 substances in 180,000 pre-registrations by December 2008. What we actually received was more than 2.7 million pre-registrations by 65,000 companies on 144,000 compounds. So it seems to become a little bit bigger. Shows the challenge to machinery, which, as I said, can handle a couple of hundred substances maximum with lab capacities at the moment. We were able to quite prominently publish an analysis what the real figures might be, just to trying to illustrate what happens if we translate this now into animal tests following exactly the guidance of the agency. And it would be about 68,000 chemicals we are expecting, which would require more than 54 million animals and more than 9 billion euro of testing costs to execute this. Something which is simply not doable. So it's a scenario which shows we need to do something to increase the throughput of our testing if we want to address some challenges, and REACH is a very good example. And this, it is the first in class, it's the first program of its kind, so it is important that we learn and adapt our strategies increasing properly throughput. In the US, the situation is not very different. We have done the very same thing as the Dangerous Substance Directive in the EU in the late 70s. TSCA, the Toxic Substance Control Act, did regulate, grandfather the old substance and only put in place some regulation for new substances. But how little control over chemicals we have, how big our ignorance towards their chemical, the chemicals' toxicity is best illustrated here. We have received 24,000 registrations, pre-marketing notifications in the US. 24,000 until 2007. Only 15% of them contain any toxicological information. And if at all, usually this is very light, very small type of testing. And EPA can request additional information on substance. They did. In exactly 200 cases, EPA required additional information on chemicals. So in the US, we have even less information on the toxicological concerns of substances which have gone to the market. This is a case, thalidomide, Contergan, you're all familiar with. For me, it was a very important personal experience. I was born in 1963, so this was just shortly after the peak. It was pure luck that my mother was not treated with Contergan. And I had two classmates which did suffer from these lymph deformations. So it is something I did grow up with very early. This is one of the concerns if you would ask people, what is risky on chemicals, on nanoparticles? They would say cancer, they would say reproductive toxicity, malformations of embryos. Let's go a little bit into these two examples. Let's take reproductive toxicity. We don't know how well these animals do predict the effect on humans. But we can ask, how well do these animals represent each other? How well does rat predict rabbit, mouse predict rat, and so on? And it's quite disappointing. The correlation is only 50 to 60%. And there's no reason to assume that any of these species is predicting humans better than they predict each other. So what does it mean if we are applying, using an animal to predict effects on humans with 50 to 60% correlation? Same for cancer. Here we have pretty good data in mouse and rat, and if we compare these, correlation is 57% between the two. No better, there's no reason that any of them should predict humans. So, what do we do in order to get the information? In case of cancer, it is a 2-year study, which costs more than $1 million per substance, uses 600 animals, and of all the substances tested, 53% turned out to be positive. So whatever we test, and we'll come back to this, the estimate that real positive rates are between 5 and 20% compared to this. So a study which takes several years is so costly, is hardly applied. In Europe, we had 5,000 new chemicals registered over 30 years of the Dangerous Substance Directive. 14 received the cancer bioassay. So in 14 cases, we have some information on cancer. For reproductive toxicity, it's faster, it's a shorter test, but still $600,000 of cost, much more animals, 3,200 per substance, and a positive rate of 64% compared to 2 to 3% real positives estimated by experts. And I will come to this in a second. So we're doing extremely costly, actually prohibitive type of test, where we will hardly apply them, and where it is incredibly difficult to use them for a broader variety of substances. They are very long, and they give us results which are not really corresponding to what we expect them to deliver. So how does it come? Why do we have such high positive rates, for example? Let's do a very simple comparison. You can say that toxicology means to find the black sheep among the white sheep. So reproductive toxicity wants to figure out how to identify black sheep. So we test 25 white and 25 black sheep with a test which is 60% correct in rats, typically the first species. And you will get 60% of these. This is not enough for a regulator, so for the more sensitive products, we require that negatives are tested in a second species, and if they are independent, we would result in 6 more of these 10 missed. So 21 of 25 black sheep are identified. This might be considered good enough or not. That's what toxicology can deliver. The problem, however, is that we have very few black sheep among lots of white sheep. Most of the chemicals we are having are not toxic. Otherwise, we would not have tripled life expectancy while we were introducing these 100,000 chemicals. So what does the real situation look like? 2 to 3% reproductive toxicants is the expert estimate. So our 25 black sheep are among 1,000 white sheep. And using a test which is 60% correct, correlating, will result in 40% false positives. And testing then the negatives in a second species, we result in the 84% correctly identified on the expense of 64% false positives. Sounds bizarre. We checked the 76 two-generation studies which were available for high production volume chemicals over the last 30 years. 46 of them were positive, quite exactly what we would have predicted just from this comparison. Now imagine testing in such type of test your wonderful new nanoparticles and labeling 2/3 of them as reproductive toxicants just in order not to miss a possible minor threat. So how is it possible? We forget, first of all, that we made compromises when introducing these tests. And I like the quote from Peter Skrubanek and James McCormick. They said, "Learning from experience might be nothing more than learning to make the same mistakes with increasing confidence." That's the way how we have got accustomed to tests which at the beginning were not without question. And to show you this, this is a letter written by FDA to Procter & Gamble introducing the two-generation study, the test I have just been discussing, in 1966, following the Contagan thalidomide disaster. What is interesting is the last paragraph. It reads, "It must be realized that even these improved guidelines reflect merely the state of the art at the present time, and undoubtedly further modifications will be needed in the future as additional knowledge in this area is developed." And exactly this has not taken place in 45 years. We are using exactly the same test which we introduced 45 years ago. So, and this is something which is common throughout. I've put here the development of technologies, in this case telephones, and put in when we introduced the various types of toxicology. Toxicology is the only area I'm aware of where we use some protocols which are essentially the same since for 90 years. Chronic toxicity in the 30s, eye and skin in the 40s, reproductive in the 60s, and so on. Everything is moving. Knowledge in the life sciences is doubling every 7 years, so we have now more than 1,000-fold more knowledge than at the time when we devised these tests. Oops, this one not. And let's go to cancer for a moment. These are the cancer rates, age-adjusted in the US. You can see all cancers are pretty stable or going even down. There's only one cancer which is going up, which is lung cancer. And we all know why lung cancer is going up. It is following cigarette consumption, and this is the cancer rate. So cancer is not really going terribly up. Still, there's some concern that chemicals might contribute to some type of cancers. If we look now for the cancer bioassay, what does it deliver? This is an analysis of almost 3,000 studies done by Bruce Ames and Louis Schwarzke-Gold. They had a look, and they found that from whatever was tested, whether it was natural substance or synthetic substance, it's about 50-something percent, 53 in average. Even half of the drugs which are marketed, which are not known not to be carcinogenic, which were later tested in the cancer bioassay, half of them were found to be positive. Even sub-ingredients of coffee, 21 out of 30 substances tested in our coffee were found positive in the cancer bioassay. And if we have a look, actually, there's even evidence that coffee is protecting against cancer. The more coffee you drink, the less likely it is to develop liver cancer, for example. So don't worry, continue to take the coffee as all lab folk is doing. So this assay is not necessarily delivering what we are looking for. Why? First of all, these are doses, and this is a log scale. The doses humans are exposed to a variety of substances which have gone into the cancer bioassay. And this is the animal test doses. So we are using test doses which are, in most cases, not realistic. We are using maximum tolerated doses. And this means up to 10% of the animals die from the toxic effects, which means necrosis in the tissue. Necrosis in the tissue means inflammation. Inflammation is a promoter of cancer, and we accumulate positive results. And this is just about the wonderful tool of extrapolation. This newlywed couple married yesterday, zero husbands, today one husband. He says, as you can see, by late next month, you'll have 4 dozen husbands. Better get bulk rate on wedding cake. It is extremely difficult to predict the future. There's another reason why we are accumulating so many false positives. And I want to use an example from a completely different area. This is clinical epidemiology. In this Canadian study, they used the 10 million residents of Ontario, 18 to 100 years old. And these 10 million people were divided by chance into two groups of 5 million. And then they subdivided the first group by the zodiac symbols in 12 groups. And they checked the 223 most common diagnoses which led to hospitalization. So, and they found 24 highly significant associations that a certain zodiac symbol brings you to hospital. And they used the second 5 million residents of Ontario to confirm these associations, and in the end, there were two highly significant ones. Leo is prone to gastrointestinal bleeding, and Sagittarians have humerus fractures. And their conclusion was very clear, and this was all done with including multiple testing, corrections, everything. They said, testing of multiple non-pre-specified hypotheses increases the likelihood of detecting implausible associations. What does this have to do with toxicology? If we do a 28-day toxicological study, we have 40 endpoints, a cancer bioassay at 60 endpoints, and a two-generation study has 80 endpoints. It is not 223, but it is a pretty high rate. So we are accumulating false positives because we are asking so many questions which should not be necessarily be posed. And still, we don't get everything. There's examples here, there's still no animal model of cigarette smoke-induced lung cancer, there's no rodent leukemia by benzene, or there's no genetic mutations by arsenic. It is not that our world would be completely safe on the expense of these high positive rates. So what are the problems of the cancer bioassay? In short, again, it is the use of maximum tolerated doses, it is the use of multiple endpoints, it is cost prohibitive with a low number of substances really tested. It is not even good to predict between mouse and rats. And quite interestingly, if we would use 200 instead of 50 animals per group, we would not have 53% positives, but 92% of substance would be labeled carcinogenic. That's the variability of the assay. So you can say that a chemical which is not positive in this assay has not been tested long enough. We're also using our data with some overkill. We had the discussion in Germany recently on dioxin and X. Bruce Ames, 10 years earlier than this previous study I referred to, said, if we use the same calculation which we use for dioxin in our food, if we use the same for alcohol, you can still drink beer. One beer in 345 years. Which shows you the levels of safety, which we apply to some of the chemicals. And we are creating by this some type of chemophobia. This is a warning, 16 toxic and 8 carcinogenic ingredients in this substance. Yes, in coffee too, every morning. But chemicals are estimated to be just 2% of cancer cases. And the problem is this gentleman, who comes from the area here too, the southern German and Swiss parts, Paracelsus, because he got it wrong. He got it right when he said, the dose makes the poison, but he said, all thing is poison. But the majority of substances is not really poisonous. And toxicology has evolved as a patchwork. Every scandal gave a patch. It looks very much like London Heathrow. It started in the 20s, like London Heathrow, and every time there was a need, an additional building was formed, something was torn down, something was built up, but it does not look like toxicology would look like if we would have to construct it newly, or like an airport would be constructed in the third millennium. I will be very short. Some of you might know that I have been heading the European Center for the Validation of Alternative Methods for 6 years, but I don't believe that it is classical alternative methods which will solve our problems, especially not for the complex endpoints of reproductive and toxicity and cancer. Here we have relatively little in the pipeline. However, I believe that there's a lot in the box for the easy endpoints, and I believe that also, especially for nanotoxicology, it will be extremely important to make best use of all the experiences we have in validating these test systems. Makes no sense that 300 million spent to develop validated alternative methods is not used, and cytotoxicity assays and other stuff is reinvented while there is 20 years of experience. There's a lot first to use from these experiences. But the situation in total is very much like this guy under the lamppost in the night. He's looking for his keys. And after a while, somebody says, but did you lose them here? Then he says, no, but here I have light. We are using the toxicological tests which we have at hand, the lamp posts, although we know that we will not find what we are looking for. Might be better to look for a torch or for a flashlight to look for the keys instead of using the old lamppost. So where's the upside? I think the first thing which is important and is which I'm trying to promote at the moment is coming from the US. It is a report of the National Academies of Sciences on toxicology in the 21st century, which was part of the title of my talk. This has created over the last 4 years an atmosphere of departure in the US, and if you have been part of some of the toxicological conferences, you might have witnessed this. It is recommending to use the lessons from alternative methods to move to in vitro, but it is first of all embracing modern technologies, the biotech technologies and bioinformatics revolution has brought about. And the basic concept is we have to map the pathways of toxicity. Just to give you a feeling for what is happening, only half a year after this report was published, an alliance was formed between the Environmental Protection Agency, the National Toxicology Program, and the Center for Chemical Genomics Testing, which was joined by FDA last year. And they said, we propose a shift from primarily in vivo animal studies to in vivo assays with lower organisms and computational modeling. Francis Collin, at the time, first author of this paper in Science, said, toxicity testing was expensive, time-consuming, used animals in large numbers, and didn't always work. His predecessor, animal testing won't disappear overnight, but the agency's work signals the beginning of an end. That's the type of wording we have never heard from American agencies before. And just, I don't go into detail, but I refer you to Science in February. There was an editorial by the administrator of FDA, Margaret Hamburg, and she says more or less a summary of the presentation I'm giving. We must bring 21st century approaches to 21st century products. So FDA is moving one of the most conservative organizations with regard to toxicity testing to embrace new technologies and make a different stand. So what is the concept of TOX21? Paul Simon said there's 50 ways to leave your lover, and the concept is there's only a couple of hundred ways to kill a cell. The idea is that there are certain pathways of toxicity, certain vulnerabilities, and if we only would knew them, we could base a different type of toxicology on this. So each cell would represent a couple of pathways of toxicity. There will be overlap between different cell types, and we can start to annotate toxins or toxin classes to the activation of certain pathways. We could have certain hazards attributed to certain pathways which need to be activated to have them. so that we could, with such a list, start annotating hazards, toxin classes, cell types and species, and really understand why rabbits show a certain effect and rats don't, because there's a difference in expression of pathways of toxicity. So taking a 30,000-foot perspective, toxicology, regulatory toxicology, started at the time when animal-based research started. We often forget mice and rats have only been used since the 20s of the last century in lab research. Before, nobody did believe that small rodents could predict something for humans. But then we had the hype like stem cells today, and everybody was using them because it was cheap and fast, and you could publish faster than using larger animals. And it was at this moment that the regulatory problems did come up because of growing chemical and pharmaceutical industry, and they used the technology of its time to solve these. Toxicology moved then to in vitro and in silico, and most of the papers in our journals today are in vitro and in silico studies, but only very little of this made it into regulatory toxicology. And in the meantime, we have moved into mechanism, into pathways, into molecular biology of these problems, and nothing of this is yet in the regulatory arena. And I will propose to you in the last part, very quickly, the concept of evidence-based toxicology to review what we are doing here, to move us into something like a systems toxicology approach. And I believe that the validation of alternative methods had the aim to bring in vitro and in silico toxicology and regulatory toxicology. But what we need at the moment is a lot of academic thinking, think tanking, to get this moved. So what is evidence-based? Because every toxicologist says, I always used evidence. It is borrowing a term from evidence-based medicine, obviously. And for those of you not familiar, the Cochrane Collaboration is the organization behind evidence-based medicine. It is a network of more than 27,000 scientists and physicians who have produced so far 5,000 systematic reviews. And actually, the US Cochrane Center is just three floors below my office in our School of Public Health at Hopkins. And we are closely working with them. So we proposed to try some of the principles of evidence-based medicine in toxicology. And the first workshop was held in 2007 in Como, Italy, where 170 people did develop some of these concepts. I will not go into much detail, but our belief is that some principles of evidence-based medicine, modern mechanistic toxicology, more biostatistics, and the lessons learned from validation will help us to do method assessment, meta-analysis of various studies, a clearer causation of health effects, and guide us also clinical toxicology, forming an evidence-based toxicology. And there's a lot of problems. We have data problems and so on. I cannot go into these details if you want to allow some questions. But most importantly, on 10th of March this year, on occasion of the 50th Society of Toxicology meeting in the US, we did create the evidence-based toxicology collaboration. We have funding now for CUT to run for 5 years the secretariat of this initiative, and we are aiming to create a European evidence-based toxicology collaboration next year as a satellite to the Eurotox in Stockholm. And you can see here industry regulatory agencies represented in the steering group and stakeholders, and we hope to develop a self-analysis process, a sparring partner process for development of new toxicological technologies. And this is complemented by the creation of T4, the transatlantic think tank of toxicology, sponsored by the Dürrenkamp-Zbinden Foundation in Switzerland, who has created three chairs for alternative methods, mine in Baltimore, Marcel Leist in Konstanz, Bas Blaube in Utrecht. And with the structure of CUT Europe and CUT, we are trying to develop these concepts. We are going to sponsor systematic reviews in the sense of an evidence-based toxicology. We are bringing in cost-benefit analysis, because I believe the most important omics is economics, and it is necessary that we take also an angle of what is the consequence of what we are doing here. And we have started a workshop series, and I think quite interestingly, the very first workshop was on testing strategies for nanoparticles, which took place in Baltimore in November last year. And there will be more of these reports. The report on this one is coming out soon. So what are my conclusions, especially for nanotoxicology? I think that first of all, the toxicology had enough problems without nano. You're amplifying the problem with the amount of tests necessary. There's some new endpoints. Toxicology was not particularly strong in lung toxicity, which is obviously a problem here. There's new endpoints like atherosclerosis, which has not never been really a toxicological concern, which might be necessary to address. The complex kinetics and difference to the in kinetics to products we have been dealing with in the past will certainly also create problems. I believe very much that we must take advantage of the experience from validation of the in vitro tests, which we have seen over the last 20 years, and I see far too many studies which are trying to reinvent the wheel where experiences are available. Toxicology in the 21st century is trying to bring a new paradigm into toxicology, and I think some of this might help also to address your area. I did not go into details on integrated testing strategies, which is, from my point of view, the most important outcome of the REACH discussion, trying not to have one test suits all type of solutions, but combining tests in a meaningful way, which is on its way, especially in the European discussion. But I also believe that we need quality assurance for what we are doing. And this quality assurance cannot be just formal validation. It takes us $400,000 and about 12 years to validate an assay. This is nothing you can wait for while you're producing your products. It will be important that we have faster ways of quality assurance, and I believe that evidence-based toxicology is one of these tools. So the 3 R's road of alternative, of reduce, replace, refine, as it is commonly abbreviated, is a road, is a fishing experience over the last 52 years since the 3 R's have been proposed by Russell and Birch. And we've been fishing with a rod. And occasionally there was a big fish, a validated test, 40 so far in 52 or 20 years, depending what you calculate. I think that toxicology in the 21st century is now introducing fishing with nets. So we are accelerating the progress towards new methodologies. And I would like to close with one of my favorite quotes by Victor Hugo. Nothing is as powerful as an idea whose time has come. I think the time to revamp regulatory toxicology has come, and you're helping us with raising the stakes. Thanks a lot.
Dr. Houghton, thank you very much for this very interesting and, should I say, enlightening presentation about testing and toxicology. Certainly lots of questions, and I would like to ask the audience to bring these questions. If there's not an immediate one, maybe I start with a question. Actually, I guess I understood that there is this problem of false positive or false negative results from these in vivo testing with animals. And this creates a lot of costs. But we will certainly have the same kind of problems with false results from in vitro testing on cell cultures, for example. And we will certainly also have a problem in identifying the correlation of these results with diseases and toxicity of these substances than with the organism. Is there any model necessary to actually get better insight into these relationships?
Okay, you're hitting on a key point. If you want to develop something new, we have to show that it will be better and can avoid these problems. And this is not a given. Most of the technologies which we are going to use are information-rich technologies. So you can say this is multiple testing, a lot of noise, and we will most probably have even more concerns. I think the first thing which we need to learn is that not everything where a biological system is responding to a substance is necessarily bad. And the more we understand what are really the critical endpoints, we can sort them out better. I think the second step is we need to move away from our black and white. This substance is a carcinogen, this is not a carcinogen. This is not what science can deliver. What we can deliver in the end is probabilities. We can, in the end, say the probability of this substance being a carcinogen is X and it has an uncertainty margin. And most probably, we will be able to say this is acceptable probability used in a household cleaner, but not in baby food. We will simply take different decisions. And we can accommodate a lot of new testing when we understand that each and every test is only changing the pre-test to the post-test probability. Because then you can live with some certain positive results depending on how informative a certain essay is. This is nothing industry likes, this is nothing which regulators like, because you cannot close the books. You will not be able to say, this substance is clean, use it forever. But unfortunately, science cannot deliver these answers, so we will have to follow up substances and we'll also change our insights on the toxic effects of substances.
Thank you.
I have a very similar question, but first I'd like to say I think you're communicating a very important message. But if I'm a cynic, I would say that it's not surprising that the methodologies, the traditional methodologies are outdated and not optimal, and it's by no means surprising that government regulation is extremely outdated and inappropriate. The real question is can you give us an example of a success story with the new approach, the systems approach to toxicology?
Yeah, I think I actually can give one. From my point of view, one of the groups which is spearheading the new developments is the ToxCast group at the EPA, very close collaborators with Bob Kevlock heading it. They had the problem last year of the Gulf oil disaster, and you know, might know that some million gallons of dispersants have been used in order to help with the Gulf. The problem was that there were 8 different substances available, and these 8 substances had to be evaluated very, very quickly in an emergency situation. What is the least toxic of this? They used 400 bioassays in a high-throughput, robotized testing format, which had been developed for evaluating of substances with them, and were able to evaluate these substances in less than 4 weeks and come to regulatory decision on the use of one of these dispersants. This was done at cost of less than $20,000 per substance, compared to roughly $5 million, which would have been spent in a 3 to 4 year exercise to evaluate them in the traditional way. We will see whether the right decision was taken, but it was at least a situation where very fast and very cheap and comforting a decision taking by regulators, biological information was used. And I think this is a very good test case of how this toxicology could look like in the future.
Thank you. All right, so if there are no additional questions, then I would like to thank Dr. Hartung again.